Hello, this is Patricia welcoming you to the 2211th edition of the Enfield Talking Newspaper, Dateline 10th of October 2019. The readers this week are Katherin, Helen, Stuart, with Dem on the controls. The editor was Patricia, and the production and distribution team is Phillip, Lindsay and Jean. Our title music is Country Rock Polka, composed by Pat Prilly, Fernand Bouillon and Harry Brewer, performed by Jean-Jacques Perry, and is used with his kind permission. The local news stories that we'll be reading come from the Enfield Independent and the Enfield Dispatch, and are their copyright. The events information has been collated by us from other sources. But a quick word before we start, we have an apology to make. Due to technical difficulties, we were unable to send out last week's memory sticks. So we do hope you can hear this, and that means the system is now back up and running as normally. Our lead story this week is Man Jailed After Frenzied and Vicious Stabbing Attack. And before the news, one more thing to add is that sunset times for the week beginning Monday the 14th of October, sunset and sunrise times are sunrise 7:22 a.m, sunset 6:10 p.m. Do get in touch with us to share your own news and special announcements. We love to hear from you. If you have any comments about the Enfield Talking newspaper, please phone Diane De Jersey on 020 8805 6578. She's your listener's representative and will be pleased to help you. And now, Katherin will read the first item of local news.
Man jailed after frenzied and vicious stabbing attack. A man has been jailed following a knife attack which left the victim fighting for his life. Jermaine Bryden, 31, of no fixed address, was jailed for 22 years at Wood Green Crown Court on Monday, October the 7th, following a stabbing on February the 25th outside Sporting Green Pub in Green Street, Enfield. After being found guilty of attempted murder and possession of a knife, Bryden was told he must serve half of his sentence and he cannot be released until the parole board are satisfied for him to be released. Police were originally called on February the 25th at 12:40 a.m. to a fight outside the pub, but after arriving, they found the 25-year-old victim lying motionless and bleeding heavily. He was being treated by a member of the public who was a veterinary surgeon, and the victim's friends who were attempting to stem the flow of blood. The victim and his friends had been drinking at the pub during the evening. One of the friends were assaulted by the defendant in an unprovoked attack, and shortly after, the men fought outside, where the victim was stabbed in the neck, chest and abdomen by the defendant. The attacker fled the scene while officers and London Ambulance Service continued to administer first aid. The victim was rushed to a specialist trauma centre with life-threatening injuries. The investigation from North Area CID detectives, assisted by specialist crime officers, spoke to witnesses and held CCTV inquiries to help identify the attacker. A major manhunt was launched in an attempt to locate Bryden after he fled Enfield. He was arrested on March the 28th in Hertfordshire and charged the following day. Bryden was then remanded in custody by the court ahead of his trial. He was found guilty of attempted murder and possession of a knife on September the 3rd. In the sentencing hearing, Judge Aramba QC said to the defendant, "You produced a knife, and in a frenzied, senseless, vicious and entirely unprovoked attack, you stabbed him again and again." The veterinary surgeon who assisted the victim was awarded a judge's commendation for her actions in saving the victim's life. Detective Inspector Paul Ridley from North Area CID said, "Bryden launched a savage and unprovoked attack on the victim, stabbing him multiple times. It is clear his intent was to cause maximum harm. He has shown no remorse, nor has he accounted at any stage for his actions, and the finding of dangerousness reached is wholly appropriate in these circumstances."
Armed police arrest suspected gunman. Armed police swooped on a suspected gunman after CCTV operators guided them to his location. Enfield Council CCTV control room received reports of a bare-chested man in his 30s walking down Clay Hill with what looked like a black handgun on display shortly after 12 p.m. on Saturday. They scanned the area with their cameras and spotted a man who closely matched his description, but now wearing a black bomber jacket with what looked like a black handgun sticking out of his waistband. The man was smoking on a bench outside the Hot Poles pub by the junction of Baker Street and Lancaster Road. Operators relayed his location to armed police, who raced to the scene. A man was arrested and a firearm was retrieved. Enfield Council's Cabinet Member for Community Safety and Cohesion, Councillor Nika Kazor, said, "Our CCTV system has a proven track record of identifying potential dangers to the public and helping the police take the appropriate action against them. I'm delighted that this individual was dealt with promptly and no one was hurt. It is never acceptable to carry a weapon, and this incident shows once again the professionalism and bravery of our police officers and the dangers they face on a daily basis doing their job. Enfield Council will continue to work hard to keep residents at Enfield Street safe and do our utmost to reduce crime and disorder in the borough."
Report reveals fears Brexit will cause medicine shortages. Enfield could be hit by fuel and medicine shortages if the UK leaves the European Union at the end of the month. Both are flagged up as medium risk in a report outlining the challenges the borough could face after Brexit and the council's preparations for disruption. The report warns fuel shortages caused by panic buying or delays to supply could impact key services. It adds that higher costs and supply problems could lead to a delay in access to medicines. Prime Minister Boris Johnson has repeatedly pledged to leave the EU on October the 31st, despite MPs passing a law ordering him to request an extension in the Brexit deadline if a deal has not been reached. If the UK exits without a withdrawal agreement, it could face tariffs on imports and customs checks at the border with the EU. The report also reveals Brexit poses a high risk to the council's finances at a time when its budget is already squeezed following nearly a decade of funding cuts. It warns £1 billion of pension investments made by the council could drop in value due to market movements, meaning the council may have to make extra contributions. Higher prices and a greater demand for services could put extra strain on the council's budget, leading to more borrowing. The council has set up a dedicated Brexit panel made up of councillors and other officials to respond to the impact of leaving the EU. It says contingency planning has already reduced several risks and it will continue preparing for Brexit. There is a low risk of civil unrest, staff shortages and disruption to adult social care, the report adds. The government has said it wants to reach an agreement with the EU but has ramped up preparations for a no-deal Brexit. It has committed billions of pounds to a range of measures, including stockpiling medicines and hiring extra board officials.
Centre's alcohol licence extended. A community centre will be allowed to sell alcohol and play music throughout the week to cater for religious events and pensioners. Darji Mitramandal Hindu Community Centre in Oakthorpe Road, Palmer's Green, has been given permission to serve alcohol from 11 a.m, 7 days a week. The centre was previously only allowed to supply alcohol from 7 p.m. on Fridays, Saturdays and Sundays. It will also be allowed to play music and stage dance performances from 11 a.m. to 11 p.m. from Sunday to Thursday. Darji Mitra Mandal of the UK, DMMUK, which owns the centre, originally applied to extend its opening hours until 1:30 a.m. on weekends and 12:30 a.m. on weekdays. But at a licensing committee meeting on Wednesday, the 2nd of October, the owners agreed to stick to the current closing times, midnight on Friday and Saturday, and 11:30 p.m. during the rest of the week. DMMUK President Pravin Jivan told the meeting, "We've applied for this licence because some of our religious events take place during the daytime. Old age pensioners especially asked us if they could have a tipple or two during lunchtime." Mr. Jivan claimed the centre had not received any complaints since 2007 and soundproofed doors and installed triple glazed windows. He added, "We've taken all the precautions we can to make sure neighbours are not disturbed." But neighbours warned existing noise, parking and antisocial behaviour problems could worsen if councillors agreed to grant the licence. One Oakthorpe Road resident told the meeting, "I've personally witnessed street fights in the road from people leaving your premises, and we've gone out there and tried to calm things down. My fear is that these issues will happen more often with an extension of the hours." Another neighbour said he'd called the centre 6 to 8 times to make complaints, and that his wife had called probably double that. He said, "When you say you've not had a complaint in a decade, I vehemently disagree." But Mr. Jivan said his organisation had put signs up telling people to leave the premises quietly, as well as installing CCTV cameras. He added, "People who wanted to use the centre were vetted to ensure they were suitable and would not cause a disturbance." After discussing the matter in private, the committee approved the alcohol licensing hours agreed to during the meeting. The owners will have to comply with 16 conditions set out by the council, including ensuring a caretaker is on duty whenever the centre is in use, keeping doors and windows shut when live music is played, and regularly monitoring noise levels.
Burst water pipe causes evacuation. Residents had to be evacuated from their homes after a burst pipe flooded a North London street. 8 fire engines and around 60 firefighters were called to assist with the incident in Queen's Drive, Finsbury Park. Video footage posted online on Tuesday morning, October the 8th, showed roads submerged in ankle-deep water. A London Fire Brigade spokesman said the flooding had affected a 500-square-metre area and that people were being evacuated from their properties. Thames Water said it was aware of the issue and that specialist engineers had been sent to the scene. Steve Stubbs, who lives in Queen's Drive, told the PA news agency, "My water didn't work when I went to grab a drink of water, so I asked my housemates whether they had any issues. Then I checked Twitter and saw one tweet about a flood on Queen's Drive. I thought, oh, that's where we are. I opened the balcony door and saw this river flowing down the road. The school looks okay as it's on slightly higher ground, but residents around the area on ground floors are having issues, I think. We are dry up on the fourth floor." Karim Trembulsi, also from Queen's Drive, told PA that he was woken up by the noise of the water. He said, "My first thought was, I probably won't be able to make it to work. Now we're a bit worried about our elderly neighbour in the basement flat. Water isn't yet coming through, but it's leaking into the front garden. It hasn't made it to the stairs or the building foundations. The water level is not rising as far as I can tell, but it's still flowing very quickly." Mr. Trebulsi said firefighters were on the street talking to residents outside. He added, "I've seen some people trying to brace the water, but it seems the fire department personnel are advising them against it, but not stopping them per se." Footage taken of Queen's Drive showed fast-moving water flowing down the street with cars still parked on the road. A Thames Water spokesman said, "We're sorry to any customers affected by our burst main this morning. We've sent our specialist engineers to the scene as a top priority, and they will be working hard to get everything back to normal as soon as possible." In a Twitter post, London Fire Brigade said 8 fire engines and around 60 firefighters had been called to Queen's Drive.
Brexit is one issue, but not the only issue. Councillor in the running to be MP. The leader of Enfield Council's Conservative group is running to be a Member of Parliament at the next general election. Councillor Joanne Laban was selected as the Conservatives' prospective parliamentary candidate, PPC, for the Enfield North constituency on September the 27th. It comes as political parties gear up for a snap general election to break the parliamentary deadlock over Brexit. Councillor Laban, who represents Highlands Ward, has been a councillor for the Conservatives since 2010 and group leader since 2017. I have lived in Enfield all my life and care about it very deeply, which is why I wanted to run to be MP for Enfield North. Labour won Enfield North in the 2015 and 17 general elections, but MP Joan Ryan quit the party to join Change UK in February this year. In September, Ms Ryan announced she would not stand at the next general election. Almost 56% of voters in the borough of Enfield backed remaining in the European Union in the 2016 referendum. But Councillor Laban nevertheless believes she has a good chance of winning the seat. She said, "I support Boris Johnson's Brexit plan. People regularly tell me they just want us to get on with Brexit. I wanted to respect the result of the referendum. Brexit is one issue, but not the only issue. I'm fully behind the Prime Minister wanting more police officers for Enfield North, more money for schools and infrastructure projects. I am known for my role as a councillor. I was educated here and live here, and that is why I have a good chance of winning."
The green waste tax has failed. Revenue shortfall from waste charge revealed. Haringey Council is facing calls to scrap a charge for garden waste rounds after it raised less cash than expected, just as Enfield plans a similar levy. A £75 a year charge for garden waste collections, £55 for smaller waste sacks, raised £200,000 less than forecast, council figures show. When the charge was introduced in 2017, Haringey Council blamed funding cuts from central government for the move and said it would help to protect key services such as adults and children's social care. But the opposition Liberal Democrats called for a U-turn on the levy after the revenue shortfall was revealed in the council's latest budget monitoring report. It comes as Enfield Council plans to introduce a £65 a year charge for garden waste from spring next year as part of a shake-up of its bin rounds. At a recent council meeting in Enfield, Seraphim Leonidas, who organised a petition against the bin changes, branded the garden waste charge a stealth tax and suggested people could end up burning their waste instead of paying the fee. Haringey Liberal Democrat spokesperson on the environment, Councillor Scott Emery, Muswell Hill, called the waste charge a short-sighted money grab. He said, "Not only is it not raising the money Labour insisted would be raised, the shortfall suggests that fewer people are now recycling their green waste. The time has come for Labour to accept that their green waste tax has failed and scrap it." The quarter one budget monitoring report says the losses on waste collections are being partly offset by income from other services and contractor and efficiency savings. Haringey's overall budget position has improved compared to the same period last year. Councillor Seema Chandwani, Labour, Cabinet Member for Neighbourhood, said the council reviews all charges and fees on a regular basis, including garden waste. The garden waste service is under review and we will be responding to its findings. Enfield Council says the changes to its waste collections, which also include a shift from weekly to fortnightly refuse and recycling rounds, will save £7.5 million over 5 years. This will allow the council to protect other frontline services from budget cuts.
Cameras installed to combat crime. The number one request was for CCTV. New CCTV cameras have been installed in Enfield Town to help people feel safer and to combat crime and antisocial behaviour. The 10 high-definition cameras in 7 locations have been paid for and installed by Enfield Council, down Holly Walk and alongside St Andrew's Enfield Church, following a number of incidents in the area, some of which involved knife crime. Enfield Council's Cabinet Member for Community Safety and Cohesion, Councillor Neneka Chiazzo, said, "We had to take positive steps to help reduce crime in this area and restore confidence. Following some concerning incidents involving a small number of people, we engaged with members of the public to see what we could do to reassure and protect them. The number one request of the council was for CCTV. We've listened and delivered. The cameras will give us the opportunity to react rapidly to emerging issues and help the police and other partners act quickly and decisively to gather evidence, identify perpetrators and protect those living, working and studying in Enfield Town. The main concern was that pupils from nearby schools were being targeted. Conversations took place between council officers and its CCTV contractor, the local church, schools, the police and community groups to see how best to deter further criminal incidents. As well as fitting cameras, some benches have been removed to dissuade loitering and antisocial behaviour. The cameras are linked to Enfield Council's state-of-the-art control centre, which has over 1,000 cameras connected to its network, which are monitored 24 hours a day to deter criminals, to help police catch offenders and to gather evidence for prosecutions.
Funding to provide secure parking hangars for bikes. The Cycle Enfield team has secured £120,000 of funding from Transport for London to help improve cycle parking facilities in the borough. This will go towards 180 secure cycle parking spaces to residents, providing safe and secure storage that will protect bikes from damage and theft. Bike hangars are covered parking units that can accommodate 6 bicycles. The first Enfield bike hangar was installed on Bouvier Road in November 2016. Since then, Cycle Enfield has installed 30 secure bike hangars across the borough. This additional funding injection will help the council to double this provision in this financial year. Enfield Council's Cabinet Member for Environment and Sustainability, Councillor Gunny Doggan, said, "Part of Cycle Enfield's plans to help encourage more active travel in Enfield are to provide more secure cycle parking to residents. Our aim is to make cycle parking as convenient as possible. Our rolling parking programme will see these fabulous bike hangers installed on our streets, particularly around Enfield's new cycle lanes where demand is high. Also, we want to help those who struggle to store a bike easily, such as those living in estates, terraced housing and converted flats. This contribution to our cycling strategy demonstrates Enfield Council's ongoing commitment to making cycling accessible and practical for all. It's about transforming active travel and improving the health and quality of our residents' lives."
Cash grant for netball courts. Top quality netball courts in London will be based in Enfield's Broomfield Park following a cash injection from Sport England. Sport England will be offering Enfield Council £100,000 from its Community Asset Fund to go towards the extensive improvements needed for the courts that currently host over 80 teams and more than 1,000 players. The 9 courts set to be renovated are dual purpose, used for both netball and tennis, and are crucial to the continuation of the North London Netball League, NLNL, which has been based at Broomfield Park since 1950. The courts have already received a £150,000 grant from the London Marathon Charitable Trust. The additional £100,000 from Sport England will be dependent on the grant terms and conditions and planning approval. Enfield Council will also be working with Historic England to ensure the improvements are sympathetic to the historic landscape of Broomfield Park. Enfield Council's Cabinet Minister for Environment and Sustainability, Councillor Gunay Dogan, said, "The importance of this funding cannot be understated. The NLNL does a fantastic job of promoting and developing talent and providing opportunities for players from all kinds of backgrounds. However, they need the appropriate facilities to continue with their work so that netball in Enfield and North London can continue to succeed at a competitive level. In addition, by undertaking these works, we will be able to encourage visitors from a wide area, which will support local businesses as well as the park itself. It is hoped participation in netball will increase by a fifth within 2 years of the new facilities being completed. Work on the new site will start in late spring next year, with an aim to finish ahead of the league's 70th anniversary season in September 2020.
Mega events cause chaos in park. Campaigners are calling for a halt to mega events that draw in crowds of more than 10,000 people to the borough's largest park. Residents groups say Trent Park in Cotfosters is being damaged by large-scale festivals held there each summer and are calling for them to be moved to a more suitable venue. This year, the park's Grade 2 listed gates were damaged by an articulated lorry servicing one of the festivals, while vehicles also churned up the park's surface. Colin Ball, chairman of Cotfosters Local Area Residents Association, and Peter Gibbs, chairman of the Friends of Trent Country Park, want Enfield Council to change its events policy to restrict these types of event. They claim Trent Park is not the right venue for events that attract more than 10,000 people at a time, including the 51st State Festival and the Elro Town Festival. The groups say part of the park regularly used by families is effectively off-limits for most of the summer holidays, while the event organisers set up festival equipment and dismantle it. And they claim many people living near the park are afraid to leave their homes due to the threat of crime and antisocial behaviour caused by some of the festival goers. More than 17,000 people were allowed to attend this year's 51st State Festival in Trent Park. The House Music Festival was previously limited to under 10,000 people, but over the years its maximum crowd size has been increased. Meanwhile, the Elro Town Festival was allowed to attract crowds of up to 25,000 people. Mr. Ball said, "This park is not the place for these types of event. We want the park used for recreation and family events. All the articulated lorries come through the gate, which is Grade 2 listed. As a result, they've damaged it. It is causing chaos. Most residents are up in arms. There are a lot of residents who abhor what is going on." Mr. Gibbs said, "We welcome events up to 10,000 people. They do not cause a massive amount of damage to the green and features of the park. But the council will not limit themselves to 10,000. An Enfield Council spokesperson said, "We are due to review our event strategy for 2017 to 2022 in the coming months. Residents and park users will be involved in that review and their feedback will be considered when the new strategy is developed. With regards to Elro, we have signed a 3-year agreement with the organisers for the event to be held at Trent Park until 2021. These events generate income which goes towards sustaining the park's service. We also charge organisers an environmental impact fee, and the money from this is invested into park improvements. We will be meeting English Heritage to discuss repairing the gates. The council will be charging the event organisers for damage caused." A spokesperson for LWE, which organises the Elro Festival, claimed there was huge local support for the event. They added, "After the event, both ourselves and the local authorities recognised there was room for improvement, but all agreed that there were no insurmountable issues and were confident that going forward, anything that has been flagged up could be rectified. We are looking forward to 2020 and will be engaging with the residents in the near future to open a dialogue and do our very best to allay any concerns. The Metropolitan Police and the organisers of 51st State were also approached for comment."
Bike scheme axed. Vandalism has led a bike hire company to suspend its scheme in Enfield, the second such firm to do so in less than 2 years. The decision by Beryl Bikes to withdraw its distinctive emerald green bicycles from the borough comes just 3 months after it launched. In an email to its customers, the company said the scheme would be suspended as we investigate issues with vandalism and availability of bikes. On the very first weekend after the scheme was launched in June, A Beryl bike was found upside down on top of a bus shelter in Edmonton. Later, another bike was found dumped in the Turkey Brook. The 50 green parking bays where bikes were supposed to be hired from were also often empty, with users finding it difficult to locate their nearest bike. Beryl's withdrawal from the borough is a blow to Enfield Council, which had championed the scheme as a way to make cycling more accessible and help reduce local car journeys. A council spokesperson said, Beryl made the commercial decision to suspend its bike share scheme in Enfield from Monday, the 23rd of September. Talks are ongoing between Enfield Council and Beryl on potential next steps. Those users with accounts for the bike share scheme should contact Beryl directly for information on refunds. A previous bike hire scheme in Enfield, run by Urbo, was not extended beyond an initial trial in early 2018. On the day of Beryl's launch, the firm's co-founder and chief executive, Phil Ellis, told the Dispatch, "This is not a trial. We're going to be here for years." A council spokesperson said the authority had not lost any money from Beryl's suspension and that it was hoped a solution could be found that allowed it to return. Beryl continues to operate in the City of London, and anyone with prepaid cycling minutes on their Beryl account can use them to hire bikes there instead. In better news for local cycling, the council has pledged to create several low-traffic neighbourhoods in the borough to help make streets quieter and safer. Deputy Leader Ian Barnes said, "Enfield Council is committed to introducing low-traffic neighbourhoods. We have a clear vision for the future, where residential streets are rescued from high levels of speeding traffic, cutting through to shave a few seconds off their journeys. We'll be working with residents to help return these streets to the people who live there, creating places where people of all ages can walk, cycle and play without fear of speeding rat runners. In most areas, the council will conduct trials so that residents can experience the changes before final decisions are made."
Free sessions to teach CPR. People are being given the chance to learn how to help someone in cardiac arrest. Volunteers up and down the country from St John's Ambulance will be providing demonstrations that include practical information on how to deliver cardiopulmonary resuscitation, or CPR, and deliver shocks to the heart with a defibrillator. It is part of the health charity's Restart a Heart campaign, with sessions in Enfield kicking off at St John's Ambulance Training Centre. Currently, less than 1 in 10 people in the UK survives a cardiac arrest out of hospital. But the free sessions are aimed to give people the knowledge to perform such procedures in an emergency. Sally Bartlett, Head of Volunteering for London and South, said, "By ensuring more people have these skills, we can hopefully increase the number of people ready to step forward and intervene." Local volunteers will be providing demonstrations at the St John's Ambulance Training Centre in Shirley Road in Enfield, and a couple of those sessions have already happened, the next one being Monday, October the 21st, from 8:30pm until 9:30pm.
Reggae band. With autumn creeping in and colder nights ahead, one of the hottest reggae bands on the circuit is taking Enfield by storm on Saturday, October the 12th, when Mystic Crew visit the Black Barn at 40 Hall. A six-piece semi-professional band have performed alongside a galaxy of international reggae artists, including Burning Spear, Desmond Decker and Maxi Priest, with a repertoire ranging from classic reggae, ska, lovers rock, roots and dub. The set will include a special tribute to Bob Marley. Robbie Bryan, Mystic Crew's frontman, formed the Northampton-based band with his brother Andrew in 1988, and although there have been a number of personnel changes, they're still going strong after 31 years. Robbie said, "Without wanting to sound conceited, we have a legendary fan base. Generation of artists have worked with us. Desmond Decker is almost like a favourite uncle. We probably play 48 weeks out of 52 weeks every year, everything from festivals to weddings. We've toured all over the country and throughout much of Europe. From year one to now, we've been in huge demand. Although Robbie writes his own song, Saturday's gig will feature a mixture of originals and covers with a section of the evening set aside to pay tribute to the late, great Bob Marley. Robbie said Marley actually came to Northampton in 1973 when I was 12. I was too young to go, my dad wouldn't let me. Playing his material is the next best thing. We'll also give you the likes of Dennis Brown, Gregory Isaacs and Toots and the Maytals. Reggae runs deep in DNA of all the Mystic Crew band members. Robbie's father was a sound system owner in Jamaica and became a promoter when he came to the UK. We mix and blend on the night. We give the fans what they want to hear, plus a flavour of our own material, said Robbie, who also has a successful solo career under the name of Robbie Valentine. We love to party on stage and are massively looking forward to it. We've heard so much about the Black Barn. Tickets are £10 and can be bought in advance from www.livestockukraine.com or on the night. Doors open at 7 p.m.
Fight for the aged. Enfield's elderly community has remained healthy, active and engaged over the last 30 years through the integral support of Age UK Enfield. The charity, part of the National Age UK network, supports older people through various means, such as through day or home care, advice and support, information and fitness sessions, and much more. Interim Chief Executive Gary Jones says Age UK Enfield will always be a crucial support service for elderly people in the borough. He said, "We aim to enable older people in the borough to lead active lives where possible, to maximise their income, and where needed we can provide day or home care. Our services are only possible with a dedicated small team of paid staff and about 80 volunteers, with our funding coming from Enfield Council, the NHS, charitable trusts, National Lottery, charges for some of our services, donations and the occasional legacy." Gary says the future aim of Age UK Enfield is to increase awareness around its services. People may know us for one thing, like advice, but not realise we also run daycare, home care, nail cutting, fitness classes and support people with dementia or at risk of falls. We want to raise more money, recruit more volunteers and reach out to more older people across Enfield. Age UK Enfield is a key partner of Enfield Connections, a local information and advice service commissioned by Enfield Council. Through Enfield Connections, residents can access later life planning sessions, which deal with issues such as creating a will and coping with bereavement. We are all about partnership working with older people, local community groups, the council and local businesses. We are proud to be linked to Enfield Connections.
Doctors' shortage. Access to medical care could worsen as the area's population increases, residents have been warned. At a Bowes Ward forum last month, one local man said, "There are fewer surgeries than we had before the flats were built. There are more flats being built around this part of the borough and we don't have the facilities to cover it." Fazila Ahmed from Health Watch Enfield was quizzed about the doctors' shortage. She said the NHS was trying to recruit GPs from other countries and added, "More GPs are retiring and seem to be leaving at the same time. What is happening is there are no GPs to replace them." Bowes councillor Yasemin Brett said a planning application had been submitted for a doctor's surgery on land owned by Notting Hill Genesis, but it was currently being held up because Enfield Clinical Commissioning Group, CCG, had not done their side of the deal.
And now for a quick round of sports updates, starting with football. Town out of FA Cup after narrow defeat to Chichester. Enfield Town's FA Cup journey came to an end as they were defeated 1-0 by Chichester City in the third qualifying round on Saturday. Lloyd Rowlett scored the only goal in the final 10 minutes to send the Step 8 side through against Step 7 Town. Injury problems had already mounted ahead of the game with the unavailability of Mo Farl and Billy Bricknell, and it got worse as Mark Weatherstone failed a late fitness test and Lewis Tarfey pulled up with a hamstring injury less than 10 minutes into the tie. Nathan MacDonald was the busier of the two keepers early on, but Chichester failed to do anything that really troubled him. Ken Charles fashioned Town's first opening of the game, but he was at too tight an angle to give Stephen Mothorpe anything to worry about. The Chichester keeper was also alert to deny Charles at the start of the second half, and the host then almost took the lead, with Enfield relieved to see Jamie Horncastle's strike bounce back off the post. Sam Young came forward for Enfield in response, but he too was thwarted by Mothorpe. Chichester skipper Connor Cody went on a mazy run forward in an attempt to win the game in the final 10 minutes, but could eventually only flick into the arms of MacDonald. Finally, though, Enfield's resistance was broken, as a neat move down the right-hand side ended with Rowlatt smashing a deflected effort past MacDonald to seal their passage. Town saw their midweek game at Kingstonian postponed due to the K's needing an FA Cup replay, so next travel to Cray Wanderers this Saturday in the Isthmian Premier Division.
Poor league run ended. Salamis deliver thrashing. New Salamis won in the Spartan South Midlands League Division 1 for the first time since August 24th as they thrashed Bedford 7-1 away from home. Dennis Mehmet scored either side of Courtney Austin to make it 3-0 at the break, and Austin added his second shortly after the restart. Luke Durnin made it 5, and then Austin sealed his hat-trick. Bedford notched a consolation, but George Lutaya rescored the 6-goal cushion late on. Meanwhile, Enfield Borough suffered a surprise 3-1 defeat to lowly London Tigers. Ali Bangura scored Borough's only goal of the game, while Gideon Sarpong's red card made their task all the more difficult. New Salamis next welcome Ainsbury Rovers in the FA Vars this Saturday, while Borough travel to Sheffield Town and Campton in Division 1 action.
Edmonton's Charles itching to get back to it. Charles ready for return to ring against Matias Rybalski. Ryan Charles says he is ready to return to the ring this Saturday when he takes on Poland's Matias Rybalski at the iconic York Hall in Bethnal Green. The Edmonton boxer has not fought since his successful bout against Colin Goldhawk in late June, which extended his winning streak since the start of his pro career to 6 fights. With plenty of rest now under his belt, Charles is itching to get going in a bid to keep his excellent form going. He said, "I'd probably about a week or 10 days after the Goldhawk fight, where I didn't really do much, but I like staying active, so I was in the gym straight after that, back to sparring and back to training hard and getting ready. I was potentially going to fight in September, but that didn't happen. I'm just ready for Matias. Training has been going really well. I've added strength and conditioning coach, a guy called Ben Lewis, who's been really good. He's improved my overall fitness and strength, and I'm much more confident now. Since coming into the professional scene with a win over Ferenc Šalek in April last year, there's been no looking back for Charles, who continues to dispose of anyone who stands in his way. Taha Mirhosseini and Miles Willington, along with Goldhawk, were unable to get past the 32-year-old, while Phil Williams was also unsuccessful in his two 2018 bouts with Charles. This superb run of form has given Charles confidence that it can continue this Saturday, even with a late change of opponent which sees him face Rybalski instead of Steve Bodger as originally billed. He said, "I'm definitely very confident. I've been training hard. I've been dedicated to it. All I've got on my mind is winning, and why not? That's what I'm in there to do, so I'm very confident I can get the win. That's things that I have been working on, and I've got a game plan. This is also my first six-rounder. There's also been a lot more fitness training involved so that I can stay strong throughout. I'm going to go in there, do my thing as usual, and go and get the win. Doors for the event open at 4 p.m. on Saturday, with the boxing getting underway at 5 p.m.
Ignatians thrash Finchley to return to winning ways. Enfield Ignatians secured their second win of the season in London 3 North West with a 41-7 thrashing of Finchley. Johnny Dixon scored a brace, while Dom Knott, Ben Mills, Dave Gear and Michael Hall also got in on the act with tries, and Jake Bates's first half penalty also added to the score. Knott was the first to go over early on, and his try was successfully converted before Bates's penalty gave Ignatians a 10-0 half-time lead. The hosts allowed Finchley back into the game after the break with a converted try, but Ignatians ran riot afterwards with a further five tries. Dixon crossed twice as Enfield turned up the pressure, and Mills was the next in line to score. The returning Gear drove across after Jonathan Hamilton's assist and Hall's fine solo effort capping things off. The side have a free week this Saturday, but return to action on Saturday, October the 19th, with a tough derby fixture away at unbeaten Finsbury Park, who are joint top of the division.
And we're going back to the news, starting off with some letters. The first is entitled Brexit is Life Changing, and it's by G.A. Musey of Mitchell Road in Palmer's Green, and it's a response. Further to end Brexit shenanigans, opinion, September the 25th, whilst I support first past the post in general and local elections, I believe the referendum in 2016 should have been resolved by a two-thirds majority because it was a life-changing decision. Had that happened, the result would have been accepted by the electorate and we would now be enjoying peace in Parliament. Mr. Kirby says MPs are ignoring their constituents' wishes, but they represent Leave and Remain constituents. And with a difference of only 4% in the result, it is no wonder there is deadlock in Parliament. Mrs. May secured a deal with the EU, but for various reasons it was rejected. Mr. Johnson says he will produce a new deal, but there is no evidence of this, and he seems determined to leave without a deal. MPs have produced an act to prevent this. Mr. Kirby says MPs won't hold an election to clear the air. But they have said they will do this when there is no risk of leaving without a deal. In 2016, the government issued a booklet warning of dire consequences if we left the EU without a deal. Those who voted to leave said it was scaremongering because nothing dire happened following the vote. They should realise it is because we are still members of the EU, enjoying our membership. The booklet is relevant today, as it was then. It is easy to rubbish the booklet, but what if it is correct?
Compulsory first aid. You never know how you would act in an emergency, yet our actions could save a life. This is why I think it's fantastic that after 10 years of campaigning by the British Red Cross, it will be compulsory for first aid skills to be taught in all state schools in England from 2020. It's an impactful way to give young people the confidence they need to help someone. As parents, Ben and I are so thrilled our children will be able to learn these important skills so that they never feel completely helpless in an emergency situation. It's also a relief knowing that if anything were to happen to them in the future, more people might be able to help. So many women I know, especially those weaning their babies, are terrified of the possibility of their child choking. But children learning first aid could make all the difference if one of their younger siblings was choking at home. This is new legislation, however, is just for schools in England. At the moment, teaching first aid in schools in the rest of the UK is optional. We support the British Red Cross's calls for it to become a compulsory part of the curriculum throughout the UK, so all school children get the same chance to learn how to save a life. Marina Fogel, campaigner.
Wear It Pink campaign. I am often asked for ideas on ways in which people can offer support to those affected by breast cancer, especially during October, which marks Breast Cancer Awareness Month. And my answer is always, take part in Wear It Pink and raise money for breast cancer research and support. Wear It Pink is the UK's biggest and boldest pink fundraiser, taking place on Friday the 18th of October and raises funds for Breast Cancer Now. Not only is taking part fun and easy In doing, you will be raising money which will make a real difference to the lives of those affected by this devastating disease. Despite more people surviving the disease than ever before, breast cancer is still the most common cancer in the UK. In 2017 in London, around 5,727 women were given the devastating news that they have breast cancer. In the same year, around 1,030 women from the area sadly died from breast cancer. That's why fundraising campaigns such as Wear It Pink are so important. Since launching in 2002, Wear It Pink has raised more than £33 million for breast cancer research, money which helps Breast Cancer Now get one step closer to achieving our ambition that by 2050, everyone who develops breast cancer will live and be supported to live well. Last year alone, over 19,000 people registered to take part in the event, raising more than £1.6 million. So will readers in London help us to beat this total in 2019? Everyone and anyone can take part in Wear It Pink. Some people will choose to hold a cake sale, while others will opt to organise a raffle, and some will arrange a pink fancy dress day at school, work or in their community. However you choose to fundraise, you will be helping Breast Cancer Now make a huge impact on the lives of those affected by breast cancer. We would love to see everyone in London ditching their everyday colours and digging out their fabulous pink outfits to help make a difference this Breast Cancer Awareness Month. So what are you waiting for? Register to claim your free fundraising pack at wearitpink.org, mark Friday, 18th of October in your diaries, and join us in helping to fund life-saving breast cancer research and life-changing support for those affected by breast cancer. Summer Kendrick, Wear It Pink Manager, Breast Cancer Now.
Joan Ryan to stand down as MP. Enfield North MP says she won't fight next election. Joan Ryan has announced that she'll stand down from Parliament at the next general election. The Change UK MP said it had been a huge privilege and honour to represent Enfield North over two separate spells as the area's representative, but that it had always been her plan to leave at the end of her current term in office. An election looks likely to take place by the end of the year. Joan said, "It has been a huge privilege and honour to serve as a Member of Parliament for Enfield North. I appreciate enormously the faith and confidence the people of Enfield have shown by returning me on five occasions to speak for and represent them in the House of Commons. When I stood in 2017, I always intended to serve only one more term in Parliament. We don't yet know when the general election will come, but I will continue to work hard for Enfield until a new MP has been elected, and my office will remain open to constituents 5 days a week. Over the coming weeks, I will also continue to do all I can to protect the jobs, businesses and livelihoods of the people of Enfield North, by working and voting to prevent a destructive and damaging no-deal Brexit, which nobody voted for in 2016. Joan was elected as the Labour candidate in 2015 after regaining the seat she lost to the Conservatives 5 years previously. But she quit the party earlier this year, citing concerns about anti-Semitism and the leadership of Jeremy Corbyn. The 64-year-old was first elected in 1997. She was a party whip in Tony Blair's government between 2002 and 2006 and a junior minister in the Home Office from 2006 to 2007, when she was responsible for the ID cards policy that was later scrapped after widespread criticism. A controversial figure within the Labour Party, Joan Ryan's initial 13-year spell as Enfield North MP came to an ignominious end in 2010 when she lost to Tory candidate Nick Dubois in the wake of the expenses scandal, after being ordered to repay more than £5,000 in mortgage interest claims. But Joan came bouncing back in 2015, but again attracted controversy in 2017, when she wrote to constituents saying they could vote for her knowing that, realistically, Labour leader Corbyn would not become Prime Minister. A year later, Enfield North Constituency Labour Party passed a vote of no confidence in the MP. She added, The people of Enfield have been a joy to work with and for. I'm proud of all we've achieved together. Fighting hard for our hospitals and for more doctors and nurses. Working with the Metropolitan Police, the Mayor and ministers to get more police on our streets to tackle the scourge of knife crime. Supporting our schools and the wonderful teachers and support staff who work in them. And working with all our communities to make Enfield a great place to live.
Urgently seeking answers. The Urgent Care Centre at Chase Farm Hospital can treat patients without needing to book an appointment. Emma Fridden from Health Watch Enfield, on plans to reduce opening hours at Chase Farm Hospital, says, "Thanks to all 372 of you who shared your views about the proposals to reduce the opening times of the Urgent Care Centre at Chase Farm Hospital. We have been busy analysing your feedback and have collated your views in a report which we sent to Enfield Clinical Commissioning Group, the CCG, in August. This is a great example of how we use your feedback to influence local health and social care services. Enfield CCG has recently proposed changing the closing time of the Urgent Care Centre from 10 p.m. to 9 p.m. This is because the busiest hours are from 8 a.m. to 12 p.m, while the last hour of service is the quietest. At Healthwatch Enfield, it is our job to amplify voices of local people on key issues that affect them. Over the last few weeks, we have collected feedback relating to this proposal and can show that 84% of local people who responded to us did not agree with the proposal. Our research findings suggest that the Urgent Care Centre is a valuable resource. Those we heard from were concerned that the proposed changes will further reduce the provision of urgent care services in Enfield and making accessing urgent care services in Enfield more difficult, and will have an impact on accident and emergency departments and ambulance services. Informed by feedback from local people, Healthwatch Enfield have written to Enfield CCG requesting that they maintain the current opening times of the Urgent Care Centre at Chase Farm Hospital. At the time of writing, we are currently waiting for a response to our letter, but we'll keep you updated when we hear more. Patricia Masinska, Chief Executive of Healthwatch Enfield, said, "Local people have told us that the opening hours of the Urgent Care Centre at Chase Farm should not be reduced. There is more work that needs to be done to provide more information about the centre to local communities. We hope that Enfield CCG will take note of local people's views when making its decision. We will be advocating for this through all available forums and meetings." You can read the full report and open letter to Enfield CCG on the website. For more information about Healthwatch Enfield and to get in touch, call 020 8373 6283 or you can email at info@healthwatchenfield.co.uk.
What's the Natter? Natter mornings take place at Enfield Market every Thursday from 10 a.m. Tony Fielding from MHA Enfield and how a simple cuppa can go a long way. On a Thursday morning, come rain or shine, residents living in the borough of Enfield are invited to come and enjoy a free cup of tea or coffee between 10 and 11 a.m. at Enfield Market. As you step off the high street and bob and weave your way through the variety of market stalls that are on offer, in the centre of the market you'll see a group of friendly faces that meet once a week to have a natter over tea and biscuits. The weekly natter mornings are held in conjunction with Enfield Charter Market, MHA Enfield Live at Home, the Old Enfield Charitable Trust and West Lee Charity Shop. The project has been set up to reduce loneliness and isolation among the older community of Enfield Borough. Recent research has shown that loneliness can have the same impact on your health as smoking 15 cigarettes a day. So the four organisations have joined forces to see what they can do to help the older generation. The Natter Mornings project has got off to a flying start so far, seeing lots of people pop by for a cup of tea and taking the opportunity to meet up with friends old and new, while putting the world to rights for an hour every Thursday morning. It's lovely watching people from all walks of life come together. Loneliness is a big challenge for a lot of older people, and we are working together to see how we can help reduce the problem and encourage healthy social relationships. They say a cup of tea solves everything, so that's where we thought we'd start, and we hope to meet more and more people over the span of the project. Natter Mornings will continue to run on Thursday mornings, 10 to 11am in Market Square, Enfield Town. Come along and join us, and let's combat loneliness together.
Move to help keep homeless families in Borough. Council says it wants to stop sending vulnerable people out of Enfield, reports James Cracknell. Efforts by Enfield Council to begin phasing out the use of temporary accommodation outside of the borough have been welcomed by campaigners. The pledge was made last month by Council leader Neshil Kalishkan as she looks to drastically cut the £7 million cost per year to the local authority of providing emergency housing. Enfield has the second highest number of homeless families in the country, with just under 3,500 households living in temporary accommodation, according to the latest government figures. Of these, 755 families are being forced to live outside of the borough. But now Enfield has become one of the first London local authorities to make such a bold promise on reducing out-of-borough temporary accommodation placements. Work is beginning at Redstone House in Harlow, Essex, to return homeless families living there to Enfield within 6 months. Councillor Kalishkan said, "We are committed to supporting people who want to stay in Enfield. This in turn will help create and support more stable and cohesive communities. It's not news to anyone that we're in a housing crisis. While the cost of living continues to rise, we are hampered by extensive cuts to our funding and reductions to local housing allowance rates. However, we are determined to use all the tools at our disposal to tackle the issue of temporary accommodation head on and eradicate homelessness from Enfield altogether while supporting those in housing need." Across London, the number of households living in temporary accommodation has risen by 50% in just 5 years. Earlier this year, the London Assembly produced a report examining potential solutions to the problem, but concluded that more government money would be needed both to help prevent families from being made homeless and to help councils cope with the demand for temporary housing. It said many vulnerable people were being left in temporary accommodation indefinitely with no hope of acquiring secure, affordable housing and were having to choose between leaving the area they call home or losing their temporary accommodation. A big factor in Enfield is that potential accommodation for local households is instead being used by other councils to house their own homeless families. Efforts will therefore be made to engage with neighbouring local authorities on ways to reduce this. Gina Needs, Cabinet Member for Social Housing, added, "Nearly 60% of our temporary housing is utilised by other boroughs. On top of this, there are simply too many households in temporary accommodation in Enfield. We need to take a transformational approach to prevent homelessness, develop relationships between residents and landlords to make tenancies successful, and make sure temporary accommodation really is temporary." The move has been welcomed by local campaign Better Homes for Enfield, who said it was a relief to see something being done about the problem. The council has recently announced a number of other policies aimed at tackling the housing crisis and improving the lives of people renting privately. One is a proposal to force landlords to apply for licenses in a bid to boost housing standards. The plan is currently out for consultation, but if it goes ahead, would mean landlords would have to meet conditions such as carrying out safety checks and ensuring properties are not overcrowded or dangerous. In addition, at a council meeting last month, Councillor Kalishkan criticised permitted development rights, which allow offices to be converted into homes without planning permission or adhering to usual quality standards, saying she wanted to restrict them by implementing an Article 4 direction. Al Sims from Better Homes for Enfield said, "Having an Article 4 direction will help to protect local employment and ensure that flats developed from converted offices are built to a decent standard. It's a pity that it's taken so long. There have been repeated warnings about this issue, but thank you to everyone who signed our petition.
Thank you, Helen. Well, we've reached the end of our programme for this week. Thank you for listening, and from the team of Katherin, Helen, Stuart, and down on the controls, it's goodbye.
Goodbye. Goodbye.
Please remember to turn over the address label in your postal packet. Put the memory stick into the packet in a closed position and return it to us as soon as possible in readiness for the next edition. Don't forget, you can call Deander Jersey regarding any help you may require in connection with Enfield Talking Newspaper on 020 8805 6578. Coming up next, the latest news and information for the Greater London area from InfoSound. The Enfield Talking Newspaper will be with you again in 1 week's time.